Hello and welcome to our brand new online show. This is Naughty Talk. We'll be having different online guests every week, different theatrical guests, different performing arts guests. I'm Mike Dickinson and this is my co-host, Trisha Duffy. Say hello, Trish.
Hi.
Trish is the writer of Broken Biscuits, which is one of the best pieces I've ever seen. Margaret, one of our guests, was the director of that. So, on our show today, the first guest, we have the wonderful Izzy Balkan from Moon Cup Theatre. Give us a wave, Izzy. Everyone give a wave. Let's all wave. Lovely stuff. We've got Liverpool actress Faye Caddick. Give us a wave.
Hey.
Hello, Faye. How are you, darling?
I'm good, thank you.
Oh, good. Lovely stuff. Over to you, Trish.
Oh, it did stick. Sorry about that, guys.
It's all right.
Please, Samantha Alton. Not Walton, which we will discuss later. She's a writer, actress, fantastic. And we also have Margaret Connell, who is the brilliant writer, director, actor, and the owner of the Lantern Theatre, which really sadly is no longer with us, which we'll discuss a little bit later in the show.
What we're also going to do is, at the end of every show, we're going to have a musical guest. So people are going to be sending stuff in, a little live performance. Today's guest is Reed Anderson, who we all know and we all love. Oh, he's popular. We've worked with Reed many times. He'll be doing a brilliant cover at the end of the show, so stick around for that, because you can't skip ahead, because, of course, we are live.
Indeed.
And it's Friday night. Cheers, everyone. Friday night. Get that down.
Lovely.
It's quite light for 8 o'clock, isn't it? Right.
Overwhelming.
Exactly. So, what have we been up to? How have we been keeping busy through all of this? Let's go with Faye. What have you been up to, darling, through all of this?
less actor related stuff, because
I
started off isolation, you know, going over me profiles, which are pretty up to date anyway, all the spotlights, and there's not really, as you can imagine, much going.
Yeah.
So away from that, I've been doing some pretty impressive bacon, Mikey.
Bacon? Really?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Oh, gorgeous.
Yeah, I've made a lemon drizzle.
Oh, I saw the drizzle.
Yeah, we won't talk about the burnt bottom because the rest of it was fantastic.
Oh, never. Some of us are partial to a burnt bottom, darling, but that's
okay. It is Friday night. What else have I been doing? I've been doing a lot of Zoom meetings with friends and creators alike, because I think that's really good for the mental health.
Yeah.
To not go crazy in isolation in the sky.
Oh yeah, you look like you're floating.
Just keep
playing with people.
And we've had good weather, and I'm very privileged to have a garden. So I've been sat in the garden listening to music.
Of course,
Which I'm very grateful for.
Brilliant. Izzy, what about yourself? What have you been up to, darling?
Oh, well, differs every day, you know.
Yeah.
I've done quite a lot of cooking as well. Making mean butternut squash risotto now.
Nice.
I've been doing quite a lot of reading. It's been nice to be able to just sort of have the time to do that again and, like, learn things.
Oh, isn't it? Yeah.
Absolutely. You know.
What have you been reading?
Well, I actually read Michelle Obama's autobiography, which was actually very nice, very helpful during these times. You know, she's got a good head on her shoulders and had to deal with a lot of stuff. I've been reading a book about an artist called Cindy Sherman. Sarah Pascoe wrote a good book called Autobiography of the Female Body. So, bit of yoga. Bit of drinking alcohol, bit of quizzes on Zoom, you know.
Talk show.
Saves us all.
Exactly. Yeah.
What about you, Sam? What have you been up to?
I'm a little bit manic, to be honest. I'll be honest, I've been a bit manic, creatively manic, and then, like, flatlining completely. So I'm either, like, doing three things at once that none of them get anywhere. Like, I'll start a poem because I'm so inspired by what's going on, and then I'll write a line and I'll go, oh, that's a good line for a monologue, and then I'll go and write that, and then I'll get fed up with that, and that's what I'm fed up with.
is getting fed up with all these things that I want to do, you know. But I've had a few days just being in bed as well, so it's very up and down.
Yeah, it is, isn't it?
That's like a wave.
Yeah.
Tell you what has helped though, TikTok, no regrets.
You're smashing that TikTok, girl.
No regrets. It's so much fun. Everyone should have a go. It's so much fun.
Do you know what, Sam? I was going to say, what's odd about that is, and we were two of them, about a month ago, we'd probably look at that and go, you stupid prick.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you're over 25 and you've got TikTok, you're a nonce. Yeah. Tried to do the pass me the sparkling water.
But now, yeah, well, 33 in. But yeah, so genuinely though, it's like, it's actually teaching people how to like make edits and stuff of that. Some of them are far better than any of the ones we'll do. Do you know what I mean? And it's like, you look at them, it's like, how have you possibly made that? So it,
yeah, you think like you've got nothing else to do ever, or never want to do anything but make that one minute video. But
and it matters, doesn't it? It matters.
Yeah, but if you have got 5 to 15 minutes to spare and you think I fancy a laugh, it's definitely a little mood up.
Yeah. And even if you don't want to make them, watching other people is hilarious.
Yeah,
no, exactly. Watching other people is funny. I want to ask Sam why she got so many wigs. Got a wig for every occasion, Sam.
I have. You know what? I counted my wigs 3 years ago, and I had 38 wigs. But I haven't. I think I've only actually bought myself one of them, right? Because it started off, I think someone just gave me one after like a fancy test because they knew I'd done acting. So they were like, oh, Sam will use that. And then a few other people done that.
You found one on a night out. You found a big white one on a night out.
A big white one on a night out. Then my best friend Louise, who lives in London, she found loads of discarded, really high quality wigs, about 7. And she sent me them.
found them on the floor outside of
a weave shop, and she just sent me them. So then I had about 12, and then it was like Faze bought me a few for my birthdays and stuff like that.
You haven't done a TikTok in that multicolored one yet?
What?
You need to get the multicolored one out.
I'm waiting for it. I'm waiting for perfect time. Faze bought me the most beautiful wig, and it's rainbow colored. And it's gorgeous. So I need to. I need the perfect character.
Yeah, you definitely do.
What have you been up to yourself, Margaret? What have you been up to yourself?
Bits and bobs. Loads of sleeping. Loads of eating food. Loads of drinking. But also cooking. I've made banana biscuits. I've made oat bake biscuits. I've made banana loaf. That made me sick. And I'm not a cook. So yeah. And I'm learning Spanish again. Still can't speak it. Been doing it for 4 weeks now. Oh. 7 hours a day.
Is it like riding a bike?
What?
Is it like riding a bike? Are you getting back to it?
A bit, but I'm just stuck at that same piece. I can read it, but I can't speak it.
Yeah, at that same word.
Yeah. Hola. Hola.
Hola. Yeah. No, I'm done. So we all know each other. We've all worked together on different things. So Izzy and Faye, you worked together on Oliver Back's Playtime though, didn't you?
Yeah.
That was how was that working together? Let's just read this for you first, and then I'm going to ask you. So this is what the blurb says for for Playtime. A brother and sister fighting for survival in a desolate world seek refuge in a room that is a relic of a time gone by. So what the fuck does that mean, guys?
Well, that's all you're going to get.
You tell me.
That's all you're going to get with Ollie's Plays. That's what's so good about Ollie's Plays is that's brilliant in his writing, creates such a surreal world that every single audience member will come out with a different idea,
absolutely,
concept of what it was about.
Yeah,
yeah. He's like the Yoda of theatre.
Yeah, he captures emotions really well and feelings, and it's sort of, you know, the characters sort of embody that. And it's quite universal, even though you might come out with a completely different meaning of what it is about. You have the same feeling about it, which I think is really special. And it's really special to have to perform that as well.
Yeah, he's got a really unique voice, hasn't he, as a writer?
He's very Pinterest-esque, I think, isn't he?
Yeah.
It's just flavours, like you get the flavours of its sense of something.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
What was it like working? Go on, Trish, sorry.
Because I have embarrassingly haven't seen it.
Oh. But
it's really good. There might
be time.
But it is Friday night. Okay. It'll be on another Friday night. In fact, so, well, yeah, if you can, try and go into a bit of detail, Faye. Tell us a little bit more about what it was. What was Playtime? And who were you in Playtime?
So I played Lady Summersby in Playtime. alongside, we were kind of, it was a cast of six, and we were kind of in like duos.
Yeah.
So I was with Lee Burnett, and he played Mosby, and we were kind of like the upper class, if there is an upper class, if class even exists in that world, who knows?
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, but we were kind of like the upper class characters that came in later on to kind of disrupt the already lacking in peaceful world that was occurring on stage.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it was good. It was a brilliant cast, really well acted. So, Izzy, and how did that come about then? Did you know Ollie's work before that, or?
It's a funny story, actually.
Here we go.
I was at Murder Ballads by the wonderful Big Blessing.
Murder Ballads, fantastic show, everyone. Go see it.
Yes, and I met Ollie there. And I have to say, I only half remember meeting him because I was a bit drunk. And apparently I was shouting something at the bar, like, about the world. And he was like, oh, she'd be great for this show. And then, I missed my bus stop on the way home, drunk, to get a taxi home. But the next day I had a message from Ollie being like, I'd like you to audition for this piece I'm doing. So I did, and I met Damon, who played my brother Tiffin in it. And, like, it was just amazing. Like, as soon as we were in the room together, like, he's such a good actor, he's so physical, and then they cast me in it, and then I got to meet Faye and loads of other great people, and it was a really good experience.
I thought you're both bloody brilliant in it.
It was such a good cast because I don't think if anyone said they'd ever went to a full rehearsal for something where there wasn't a time where they were a bit like, ugh. Whether it be about the play or people they were working with or whatever. Exactly. But what I found with Playtime is we never had a moment like that. It was never a task to go to rehearsals. It was always very, very enjoyable and a really good cast to work with.
Yeah. It's going to be on again, isn't it? Playtime, we can catch it again.
Yes. They've rescheduled it, I think it's the 7th and 8th of May next year at HG. Yeah.
Is that all you can announce? No exclusives?
I don't know. I think that might be an exclusive.
I feel like that was.
We were meant to go to Edinburgh, of course, as well this year. So whether that's being postponed or I don't know.
I'm sure it will. I think it would be very odd of the Fringe to, because of this circumstance, to not just push everything that was booked to the
back.
I think it would look terrible on them if they didn't. Not push everything forward. And Sam, Faye, you've worked together, of course, many things, but of course those 2 weeks with me as well. So Sam, how was that? Was that the third time you've done it?
Yeah, I think it was
the and how was that going back to it again?
I just love that play. As soon as someone says those 2 weeks, I just feel a bit warm and fuzzy.
Written by
Ian Salmon, and it's just such a beautifully written play, and it's just got like natural Scouse humour, and even though it's horrible subject matter, it's just tackled in a lovely way. So every time that I've done it, I've absolutely loved it. But the time that we performed in front of families and the Hillsborough survivors was just like an unreal amount of emotion in one room, and I don't think I'll ever get that feeling again after the show doing that. And then when we did it the last time and Faye came onto the cast, that was just like the icing on the cake, because me and Faye
What was it like to join that cast then, Faye? Because you'd seen the show, obviously, hadn't you?
Yeah. It was a real privilege, to be honest, because I went to see it when they did it at the Unity Theatre the first time round, and thought the cast were brilliant.
Yeah.
And obviously, you know, very, very emotional. subject matter for the city, such a tragedy. And you know, I'm a Blue, but it's a subject matter where all that is just put to bed, and Blues absolutely. And Reds across Liverpool are united. So yeah. it's a real emotional fly on the wall piece from Ian Salmon, and it is an honour and a privilege to do it. And when we did it at the Epstein, which that was my first time performing at the Epstein, a couple of nights we came out to, you know, stand innovations, and you know, very, very powerful to see grown men and women in the audience, very, very over emotional.
And no one afraid to show that, really, was there?
Yeah, really powerful, really powerful. And you just feel honoured to be trusted with a piece of work like that, because it's so important and emotional.
Absolutely.
It's fantastic.
Worked with Margaret on a lot of things as well.
Yes.
Yeah.
We've become a bit of a dream team lately.
Indeed.
A bit of a dream team.
Yes, we...
Power.
Indeed, yeah.
Ball of fire. I mean, they've sold out four times at St George's Hall.
It's mad, isn't it?
Rave reviews. So, you obviously must enjoy working together. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, I mean, I love working with you, Margaret.
Indeed, we just fall into a little rhythm, don't we?
Yeah, I feel I'm one of the children.
Yeah.
3 hours with each other. I definitely spent more hours with you than I have my own mother last year.
Yeah.
Definitely.
And because it is only the two of us normally in a rehearsal, you've got lots of other actors as well. But it's just us two, so you can just mooch along at your own pace.
Yeah.
But it does seem mad. We are for hours together in one room.
Hours and hours. Because we always knew of each other, and we always knew each other to stop and have an atta, but we'd never worked.
Yeah. Exactly, and yeah.
All of a sudden, we went from doing nothing together to having three different shows.
So literally, yeah.
That's a lovely relationship to have. Definitely.
It is, it's great, it's so stress-free. And you realise that when you maybe go into another project and suddenly go, oh, this is a bit hard, negotiating all these people.
We're both working with John Maguire as part of Arts Groupie, and I think the three of us especially work really well together.
Absolutely.
Like the way we kind of share ideas, and
to me. Yeah.
Write a bit of weave.
Just works, doesn't it?
Yeah, so I wrote a little bit of weave, well, about half of it.
Most of it, really, because it changed completely, didn't it?
Yeah, so what happened with that was we were riding kind of the first success wave of Kitty, and whilst we thought we had a bit of a captive audience, John had this second one-woman show that he had on the back burner, and he'd done it at a scratch night about 6 years ago. But we were that busy with Kitty, we had this idea to put Weave on, and we were like, let's just book it.
Get it done now,
We sat for Kitty, let's book it in. And we just thought that we'd have more time somehow from somewhere. And then finished, we had the weekend off, and then we were like, oh my God, we've got a show to put
on. Just start.
And we've only got about 25 minutes worth of dialogue.
So
over about... Like the first two weeks of rehearsals, wasn't it, Margaret?
It was literally just plotting it out. And so we'd sit together and decide what the scenario was, where it was going. Then Sam went home and wrote the lot.
Workshop little bits and see what works whatever. But we finally got it on. It was so stressful. The whole time. I felt like I was going to have a heart attack every day.
We performed it
and we managed to sell it out, and we got a celebration. It was just wow, that was the most.
And it really worked. Something about I work well under pressure, though, as do you. Because we've always got so many balls in the air, we're juggling that much, aren't we? Yeah. So once you throw yourself into something, it was a bit of a miracle that it worked.
That was definitely a bonding exercise.
Without a doubt, yeah.
So enjoyable as well, so enjoyable.
It was, and it turned out really well. It was a really lovely piece.
Yeah.
Got loads of legs.
Yeah, massively well received. I've seen brilliant, and Kitty.
Yeah.
Brilliant the way it works with all the team.
Yeah.
Quite,
quite dynamic to have that. I mean, I would imagine that's quite unusual to find in work scenarios when you get that close.
Yeah, I do. I think there's something about the dynamic of the three of us. I think John makes things happen. And
oh, absolutely. He's got a massive energy and his belief in everything. He's just positive about everything. It's just not what we might do this or let's try this. This is what we're doing. And it just happens. Yeah.
You've got like years of experience in every part of the theatre world. And then I cannot help chiming in with my ideas. My teacher can't keep my mouth shut and sometimes
I like that though. I think it should.
Oh, I know, love.
A real collaboration.
It helps us all, and it's good.
Izzy, you've come on, then let's have the question of the night. So, what's moved up? Oh, on Friday night.
Friday.
So, Izzy, tell us, please, what is Moon Cup? And be careful. No.
I can tell you what a Moon Cup is. You can Google what a Moon Cup is. Moon Cup Theatre, it's like a woman-led company or collective or cult, whatever you like to call it. We were founded in 2007 when Hope Sheet, unfortunately, which is not around anymore, had its On the Verge Festival. So we put our first show on a bus and it was all about Brexit. But yeah, like we try and just do work that sort of is like a reaction about the world that's going on around us. It's usually quite politically driven. We try and focus on like women's stories, queer culture being celebrated. But like community is one of our main focuses and sort of trying to reach, you know, everyone and sort of get connected and use sort of theatre as sort of an activism sort of thing in a way, I guess.
Yeah.
That's where our head's at the minute.
That's brilliant.
We often do like lots of dancing and comedy and singing. So
I see that you did a project with one of the colleges, didn't you, not long ago? What was
yeah, that? So we did a residency with City of Liverpool College in February. And it was like 2 weeks of like radical theatre. So we ended in a show that they made, which was amazing. It was a response to sort of what's going on in the world. But
did you show them some of your work?
Well, we actually started the residency doing our drag. So I started the whole residency dressed as a man. And then I did a poem about women dressed as a man. But we took them all out in drag. So we got all the lads dressed up in like female clothes, the opposite. And took them out into the streets of Liverpool singing I Want to Break Free. And they had to sing to dance into Fly on the Wings of Love. And they all had big protest signs. So we did like a big gay protest, queer protest in the middle of Liverpool. And that was amazing. You know, like I got more out of it than they did. It's probably the best thing I've done working with those guys, you know. But yeah, that was fun.
That's brilliant. And of course, Margaret, you know Moon Cup well. I know Siobhan.
Yeah, yeah.
She absolutely loves them. There was the thing that Siobhan ran after the election. Let's not go back to that day. But after that, she did the 24-hour play. So you put something together, Izzy, didn't you, Moon Cup?
Yeah. I only knew Rebecca.
Yeah.
She's done stuff at the Lantern. She did one of the Shine New Festivals.
Oh, yeah.
So I knew all the work and I've seen her work solo as well.
Brilliant.
But I met Izzy that day for the first time. I saw it obviously in back to Ollie's piece.
Yeah.
And that first of all, and she was absolutely amazing. Her eyes are that pierced and I genuinely thought she had contact lenses in. Girl's got really bizarre contact lenses in.
Have you got any do you have any planned upcoming shows obviously for when the dust has settled? Have you got any planned shows coming up, Izzy?
We're currently working with Homotopia, who are supporting us. We're creating a piece all about gender, actually, which it's sort of in the research and development stage at the minute. It was called What is a Woman, but it's sort of moved on a bit to sort of the whole spectrum and the world right now and asking questions, because everyone's very confused and everyone's getting very, you know, angry and, you know, there's voices that need to be heard, but also doing our scratch nights, which we run. So we usually do them not in lockdown, But it's usually in that where we make food for everyone and anyone can come and show whatever they want. And you get like a little raffle ticket. So you can either just say hi or you can show whatever. It doesn't even have to be the arts, it can be science.
Yeah.
But we're hoping to do another online one on Saturday the 16th of May. So
get your plug in, everyone.
If anyone wants to show anything, you know, feel free to just send us an email with your work.
We'll put the link to that in when we post this this evening, of course, on Friday night. Thank you. So what we're going to do now is we're going to take a quick break, only literally a minute break. You can't fast forward it at the bottom, everyone, because we're live. So have a little look at the adverts. When we come back, we're going to talk about the Lantern Theatre and what that's done for everyone. And of course, we've also got our musical guest, Reed Anderson, at the end as well. So stick around and we'll see you in a moment.
Yeah.
So as you can see from the lighting, it's still Friday night. Let's drink to that. So the role of Queen Victoria came about a lovely lady called Pauline Lovin, who was one of three fantastic women who run Crow's Eye Productions. They have their own channel, YouTube channel, Crow's Eye Productions on YouTube. And they recreate wonderful costumes, a lot of them handmade as well. Pauline is so talented in making them. And they do films on the history of dress throughout the ages, different periods of time. And they were hoping to cast for Queen Victoria and Prince Albert for a piece called Getting Dressed in 1848, Christmas. And it was recreating the scene that appeared in, that was published, should I say, in Illustrated London News. And it was the picture of Queen Victoria, Prince Albert, their children, and some of the helpers of the house around the first Christmas tree to ever be published. And that's what they were recreating. So she apparently had scanned through loads of headshots on Star Now to find someone who had a likeness to Queen Victoria and came across my headshot. I'm not sure whether she contacted me on Star Now, because I'd actually been neglecting that a little bit. And obviously because I've got my spotlight, which I put everything into that. So she contacted me directly, direct message on Twitter, saying she'd found me, tell me a bit about the role of the project. Would I be interested? And of course, I wanted to, some filming experience. So I went down in the August of last year to meet the team, Pauline, Nick and Liv, and to have measurements done for the dress that Pauline would be making, a replica of Queen Victoria's dress. She took all the measurements, met the team, really lovely. And then I went back down in the October and we shot the film over 2 days. The first day of filming was basically me getting dressed. So it was me starting in my undergarments and then adding the layers as they would have back in the day. So we got all them shots done on the first day and we filmed that in Normanby Country Hall Park, which is a very grand manor, filmed there. And also it doubles up as a museum, so that was quite interesting, contending with what we could and couldn't touch in the rooms. So we shot that on the first day. The second day of filming, they shot Prince Albert, the same getting dressed. Prince Albert was played by an actor called Joshua Gould. They shot him getting dressed. And the later part of that shoot day was us coming together and recreating the scene with everyone. around the Christmas tree. And it was a lovely experience. It was really, really lovely team of creatives. Nice to do a bit of film again, because I'd been doing a lot of theatre. It was fantastic, and came away from that really happy. And then they released the film in time for Christmas, and it's, the views have just taken off. And I think at the moment it stands at 6.3 million views, which is just incredible. Incredible for the company, and just incredible for me, really, as a up and coming actor, to have that kind of exposure. It was just a really, really positive experience, and it is just amazing to see the views of the film going up and up. Brilliant.
Shoot a messenger, string them up. She's a 10 plus 10, not enough. Mixed messages, wires cross. Marry me, what you got too much? Toothbrush and socks. Parents meeting Mayfair, couple dogs. We go on walks, she never talks. I put my heart out, she laps up my blood. Blue light, double vision. Our races like supercars.
Okay, welcome back. So I should just clarify that, yes, the sheep dates have moved to October, of course, because April is well and truly gone.
Beautiful, isn't it?
Yeah, it's fairly good.
Yeah.
So in that little clip of adverts then, we saw some shows that we've got coming up. Now, we probably wouldn't... we probably wouldn't be going unless we were given a chance at a theatre that used to exist in Liverpool called the Lantern Theatre, which was ran by Margaret and Siobhan and Dan. And so who out of all of us here, I know Trish has, who's had shows on there? Have we all performed there?
Yeah, I haven't.
Have you not?
I've seen. Well, when I left uni is when it sort of, you know, unfortunately sort of, so I never really got the chance to, but I had a lot of friends.
Yeah, no.
funny story, I actually studied the Lantern Theatre in first year and had to do a PowerPoint presentation. So you and your Siobhan are on a PowerPoint on my laptop.
Somewhere. I would love to see that.
There you go.
PowerPoint,
Margaret, there you go. So Sam, what have you done there? I know you've done a few things there.
Do you know what?
I've probably done more than anyone else.
Me and Sam have both done together in Jefferson's Tale and Accrington Pals.
Yes, we've done that.
Full
bell ringing in my room. me and Faye have done a few together. I've done a few like just with little groups after uni and stuff, but I'll always just remember the Lantern because it was like the first place that I did perform after graduating. And we'd done Waiting for Godot. And I just remember thinking, God, this is one of my favourite plays. I'm performing in a theatre. People are paying to come and see me. I've made it. That was in 2013. And here I am.
you closed,
feeling.
And Sam, you actually closed the last Shiny New Festival there in Dirty Glitter, of course.
Yeah. That party, do you remember, Margaret, and you sang?
Yeah.
Oh, amazing.
Yeah. Oh.
Fantastic.
This is all we ever say, Marg, isn't it? Margaret can sing.
I know, yeah. 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 I know, mad, isn't it? Yeah.
A very good book she has too. Yeah,
the lantern was just, it was everything about it. It wasn't the place, it wasn't just Margaret and Siobhan, it wasn't just the plays that were on, it was the whole community, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. That's what I loved about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it was very, very sorely missed, and extremely sorely missed up until about a year ago, when the Art Bar lads started.
Oh my God, yeah.
That was so similar. And now it's, you know, to me, the lantern's untouchable, but it's got a really good second.
Oh, absolutely. I always say it's like Cheers, isn't it, the Art Bar? Go in there any time of day or night. It's just comfortable, isn't it?
Yeah,
it
is. Like second
home.
Yeah.
As Mikey, you know, touched on, a lot of us wouldn't be here without you and Siobhan and the Lantern Theatre, and definitely not myself. I'll hands off. I mean, you directed Broken Biscuits and everything. I've got everything to thank you for. But what would you say were your highlights of having the Lantern Theatre and then the lowlights of having it? Because I think people just think, oh, you own a theatre and...
Yeah.
It is amazing, but I'm sure it's not always amazing. So do you want to fill us in a little bit on
that? The highlight obviously was being able to give a platform to that many new emerging young artists, writers, directors, actors. And it's a real privilege to be there at the beginning of someone's career and go and see something in them and go, oh, I know they are really going to go somewhere and do something. But being part of that hub, part of that community, and seeing people get to know each other and watching that sort of real community that now exists in the Art Bar, watching that begin to grow, because I think there'd been a bit of a gap somewhere in the way artists work together in Liverpool. When I left teaching and decided to open a venue, I was a little bit gutted that there didn't seem to be any threads between people. There was people were off doing bits and bobs, but there was no sort of links and connections. Everything was happening in different little pockets. So I think the best thing for me that the Lantern did was brought all those things together and created a real community where people now share and collaborate and work across different companies and stuff. The worst thing about it was that when I took it over, I really thought it'd be a massive opportunity for me to direct more work. Because obviously, as a lecturer, I used to direct a couple of shows a year, but I wanted to have more choice over what I was doing. And what I found was I only really got to make about 3 shows the whole time I was there, or be involved at 3 or 4 at the outside. I was really just hosting other people, which was great. But the thing that I love about not now being tied to the Lantern is I can accept any work anyone offers me.
Yeah.
And I can get to do a lot more of my own stuff.
Do you think there's room for somewhere, this is to everyone now, do we think that's something that's missing now from Liverpool, is a venue like that? I certainly do.
I don't think you can have enough small venues. Look at Manchester.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I still think the
beauty of those small venues is they bridge that gap between emerging or up and coming, I don't know, young theatre companies who find the bigger venues inaccessible, whether it be because the bigger venues are very exclusive to the companies they've already got, or they're priced out because the rental fee for one night, two night, three night of shows is just ridiculous.
I think that's the beauty of venues like that.
You can
take a chance
on things.
Where is it
that you run your scratch nights?
We've just moved.
Exclusive.
We used to perform at 17 Love Lane, which is sort of near the Invisible Infatuary Ways. It's like an old
venue. Oh, it's a lovely little venue. Yeah.
Yeah. It was run by Annabelle Little, and we got it after we did On the Void. The Void was our first show, and then we stayed there and put on cabarets and stuff. And it's a great venue. But we've just moved. It's just been taken over by some. By Quarry, there's a band Spine, and they've turned into sort of a music venue. So that's really cool. But that's where we did a lot of our stuff, and that was honestly like we've just moved to Metal, our Ed Shore station.
Yeah.
But it was so I'm so happy that we got to have a space to start our company and to explore and to experiment and to be able to put work on, because I honestly feel so privileged that we got that, because I know it's so hard to find any venues and space.
Yeah.
And you know, we got to like rent it for quite cheap, and it was vital in us, you know, getting to just try stuff out. And that's why these small venues are so important, because you know, we get to grow, we get to try, we get to fail, we get to build our work. And you know, we can't be affording these big venues, and also
you've got
to get their attention first, haven't you? So I think it's really important to create these spaces for us all. Yeah. Absolutely. But I was very lucky to have that.
Yeah, no, I agree. Do we have any projects coming up then? Out of everyone, what do we have coming up, Margaret? What, let's start with you. Have we got anything coming up?
Well, we were hoping to take Kitty to London, but obviously that's had to be.
Is that an exclusive, Margaret?
I think it might. No, I think we've told people that, haven't we? Definitely.
Just say yeah. Just say yeah.
That was a massive exclusive.
Okay. Yes, it was.
I know.
Carry on anyway.
We've had to shelve that, so but we're talking to a couple of theatres about possibilities for when they reopen.
Lovely.
We also really wanted to take it to New York, but again, that's off the cards.
But once we're all back, that's a good thing. It is in fact, but we'll get to that in a moment. Actually, we'll edit that one out. Right. So Faye, what have you got coming up? Anything planned?
So I think Playtime is postponed until 2021, which I'm looking forward to. Also, really unfortunately, right when the lockdown happened, I was in rehearsals for a wonderful night that was going to be called Finger Food Shorts. That was put together by Zula Erickson. She had brought together a group of writers and they were given a theme. I believe the theme was confession about something. And they all wrote monologues and they were going to put them on back to back, and that was going to be at the Playhouse Studio at the end of March.
Yeah.
So obviously, with everything, the theatres got closed down right before that was going to go on. So fingers crossed, that's also a postponement, not a cancellation, and that will come back on, because I was really enjoying that. I was having a great time in rehearsals. Zula herself was directing it, and she's fab to work with. And it was the piece I was performing was by Lisa Holdsworth, and it was brilliant, really interesting character, you know, not two dimensional for female, which is so important.
Oh, absolutely.
So hopefully that will be coming back around, and then November in the Epstein, the comeback special.
Oh, of course.
And Naughty Corner is coming back. One of my faves.
Well, Faye, congrats on getting that role anyway. And look, I think there will be, you know, I can't see any reason why projects that were happening, people wouldn't want to do them and carry on with it.
Oh yeah.
If not more so after this.
Yeah.
So you know, stay positive with that. Sam, what about yourself? Coming up, anything?
So there's the Kitty stuff, which is a little bit on hold, but we're in contact with theatres for London. And then I've got Raves R Us with you. I think the first scheduled show is going to be Sound City. And
you're putting me on the spot.
Anyway, I don't know if that's an exclusive or not, Mikey. But
have a drink anyway.
So I'm at Raves is ongoing, and Kitty is definitely not put to bed. But I'm also writing a play. I'm writing a play at the moment for me and Faye, which is going to be a two-hander.
Now that's an exclusive.
Now that's an
exclusive. I knew, but no one else knew. So.
Now that's an exclusive.
I did write a first draft and I recorded and listened to it back. I've since, in the last 24 hours, had a bit of a brainwave with it and changed direction for the better. So I'm really excited.
Okay, brilliant.
When I'm going to be able to put it on, new writing, because all the theatres are going to be backlogged. So it might not be till 2023, but it's going to be amazing.
Yeah.
It'll happen.
Do we have a working title or an idea? I have got a working title.
Come
on, let's have the exclusive.
Classified information.
Classified information, because I'll tell you for why. The title sound. The title doesn't sound like it's anything amazing, but what it is will be.
It means so much.
You've got to tell us the title now, Sam. You've got to.
It's called The Things We Say.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
That is.
I know.
No. That's not a bad title. It's not like bread.
It's definitely not a bad title in relation to what she wrote.
Yeah. It's called The Things We Say. And if anyone out there puts out a play called The Things We Say, expect me to hunt you down and gut you like a So, yeah, that's what I've been up to.
on broken biscuits as well. Carry on.
And Izzy, what about yourself, love? So I think we touched on it, but the plans for what's coming up?
Yes, we've got Playtime. Hopefully we're going to be touring Hip Hip I'm Gay again, which I did last year, which was with the wonderful Ashley Owen.
Did you do that at the Royal Court studio, is that right? Was that
we did it at the Royal Court, and we took it on like a little national tour. But that's all about the LGBT community and mental health struggles, but it's sort of like a comedy cabaret, so it's like verbatim. So hopefully we've got one date booked for October at the minute, but I don't know what's going to go on with that now, you know, booking tours is not. But hopefully that'll be on soon. And then, yeah, Moon Couple is still working. We did a show called The Glamour Knots, which was about women in space, so we're hoping to go around, maybe take that into schools or science things to promote science for girls, you know.
Yeah,
and also I've been working on some like drag stuff, so I'm hopefully going to start doing some drag workshops. Well, I was supposed to be, but not now, but
we will
some more dragging up and fucking the system, basically. Yeah,
yes, we love it.
It is Friday after all.
Friday. On a Friday, people. Right, now we get to the serious part. Okay, so this is now a weekly competition which will happen. So everyone at home watching, what we need you to do is, as you hear the following embarrassing stories, you must then comment whose you think, after you've heard them all, don't just vote for your fucking friend. You have to get to the end, you must say which you think is the most embarrassing. Then each week there will be a leaderboard, okay? And we will work it out by the end. So if you think that it is FaZe, you will put A. If you think it's Izzy, you will put B. These will all be at the top, don't worry. You can see it up there. If you think it's Sam, you'll put C. And Margaret, you will put D. Okay, you have, we'll give you 20 seconds. Yeah, I've got to do it, you got to fire it out, okay? 20 seconds to say each one. We're gonna go with Izzy, are you ready? We'll have dramatic music underneath. Johnny, so your most embarrassing moment on stage. It can be yours or your company's or someone else. Are we ready?
Okay.
Off you go.
Okay, so it's probably in a school actually. We did a math show, TIE, and I was supposed to be doing a clock, and I was on stage on my own, and my friend was supposed to do the times, and he said all the wrong times. I was stood there like a knob on my own, pretending to be a clock. The head teacher was staring at me in the eye. There was about 60 little kids there. The time's wrong. We were trying to teach them maths. And I died inside. Honestly, there was nothing I could have done to get out of it. And also, my time sounds not that good. So, yeah.
I like it. It's good. We give it a clap. We like that. Right. Let's see. Sam, are you ready?
God. Okay.
Off you go.
So, So I was working for Farmageddon, and I was a clown, and I was working with Adam McCoy as well, who was also a clown, and people were walking through all day, and we were getting quite bored of just doing the normal, like, jump out and scares, and there was this old man, and we thought it'd be funny to, like, get him into this wardrobe, which was there for just, like, set design. Me and Adam McCoy got this old man in a cupboard, and it was dark, and we were just screaming, going, "Ah!" And we thought it was hilarious, right? Later that night, the guy who owns Farmageddon was like, "I think some people have stepped above the stations tonight, haven't they? Does anyone want to say anything?" And I didn't say anything, and he was like, "Well, I'm just going to tell you, I've been hiding in the walls, and I know what's happened tonight." And me and Adam McCoy were just like,
"Hiding in the walls.
God. Bizarre."
Yours is a horror story, Sam.
That was the most embarrassed that I've ever been. I don't know. It was
good. These are good stories. I like them.
Idea. And then I was like, that was really mentally scarring for that old man.
Well, let's hope he's still with us. Right, yeah. So let's go. Faye, what about yourself? So,
the funniest times I remember having on stage, and I hope he doesn't mind me saying this, but I was working for Love History, and they were doing tours of the catacombs in St. George's, and different actors were set up different spots. And myself and James Ledger we're on the very bottom, and so they had to, like, come down towards the audience. Obviously, we're ghosties, so we had, like, costumes on that were all dishevelled and ripped and stuff. And Jay and I were, like, performing on, like, this platform, so the bottom half of our bodies were probably eye level with the audience. And Jay was like, I don't know, some kind of kex in a shirt, and he just wasn't very happy with his costume. He didn't really think he looked that ghosty or whatever, so we were trying to make it a bit better. So we ripped one of the holes to look a bit more dishevelled, and the whole front of his pants, like, fell down like a flap. And he had, like, I don't know if they were like Simpsons or what, but like bright blue boxes on.
That's
and he was
good.
Like, panicking, and he was like, because they were coming around like groups like every 30 seconds, and he was like, "What am I going to do? How long have we got until the next group?" And I was like, I don't know what we're going to do, like panicking over lines. So he was like, I'm just going to have to do it. And so the next group came, and they all just like walked up to the plinth, and we all had to be like, yeah, ghosties. And he was just there with like his bright blue bills, completely eye level with the poor woman who was like at the front of the crowd.
That's brilliant. No, it's good.
Not
That's
my brilliant. Story, but. Sorry, Jack.
No, that's fine. It could be anyone. It could be absolutely anyone. Margaret, come on, then let's have one.
Oh, God, I can't think. Was one time we were doing a show in Edinburgh.
Yeah.
And I always get really nervous watching mates perform. You're terrified of something going wrong for them. And so it was a youth theatre show. So all the stuff we brought with us was all the kind of stuff you'd use in youth theatres. You know them blocks? Like a square block, and we've made stairs out of that. So one of my friends was supposed to be, it was a play about a day in the life of an abortion. So it was relationships between different people and how you ended up getting to this place. So he was supposedly walking up the staircase to get into bed. So this girl, Colette, was playing the girlfriend. He put his foot on the first step and just put his foot right through it and couldn't get his foot out. I was like trying to shake this box off his foot. And I genuinely, when you watch, I thought I was going to have a heart attack with nerves.
Oh, they're good. I love them. They are
brilliant. Mikey, do you know what one I should have gone with? I've just come to my head now.
Do you know, are you changing it now?
I don't know. Do you know which one I'm just thought of?
Go on.
Megan at the end of bar.
What, when a lion, no one laughs?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I just remembered.
Just to fill anyone in who's watching, at the last show, Bob the Russian, sometimes, especially my shows, the casts go a little bit crazier. They try and plan things that are going to be very funny, things that are going to piss me off or make me laugh. Megan tried something which she seems to have built up in her head, And I don't remember exactly what it was, but no one laughed and she just ran off stage. Megan Bond, we love you. Megan, that was funny. Yes, and there's another one, of course, where Megan actually broke character, was laughing, and then the audience noticed her laughing and she couldn't stop. And the corpse was well and truly on stage.
Can I tell you about some post-show embarrassment?
Yes.
So me and Faye were both in a show, and I won't mention any names. we were in this show for about, we were rehearsing it for about 6 months, and we rehearsed about 50 nights a week, and every single night, the director decided to change the movement, and it was a very movement-driven piece. Mm. It was infuriating, wasn't it, Faye? We were rehearsing for a while, finally got to performing in the Unity Theatre for the very first time, made up, I'm in a professional theatre, fantastic, my mum and dad came to see it, went out, what do you think? Yeah, it was really good. Got home and I was like, what did you think? And my dad was like, I didn't really want to tell you, Sam, but it honestly just looked like a band of brothers had come out of the community church, I don't know. And me and Faye had spent about 120 hours rehearsing with this show. My dad had to say it. So that was
the best dad reaction ever.
A band of brothers coming out of a community church.
Well, that's beautiful. Can I just say this, and thank you very much to all of you for joining us. Honestly, thank you. It's been lovely. It's been the first one. Next week, by the way, we'll just let everyone know now. Next week, one of our guests is Margaret. You may know him. One of our guests is Mike Noble.
Oh, yeah. Ring a bell.
He played Christopher Boone in the Olivier Award winning The Curious Incident of the Dog in the Night. And he's recently been in the last revival of Jim Cartwright's Road. So he'll be on, which my students, by the way, at LMA were meant to be doing. So they can tune in if there's no language.
My favourite show, the first show I ever did when I went back to acting, Road.
Oh, is it? Yeah.
I love Road.
Played Valerie in it. Yeah, I absolutely adore it.
And Trish, who else have we got on next week?
So Daniel Taylor, who's a Liverpool legend. He has been in Blood Brothers for 20 years. He has Daniel Taylor Productions, and he has brought Shakespeare back to Liverpool to the Epstein with A Midsummer Night's Dream, Romeo and Juliet, Macbeth. He also wrote The Tommy Cooper Show, won awards for that, and plays John Lennon, which is the only play Yoko Ono has okayed in Lennon Through a Glass Onion.
Oh, and that is next week, and which rounds us off beautifully, because now to close out the show, we have Reed Anderson, who will be doing, and this is, honestly, this is stunning. It is a cover of John Lennon's Working Class Hero. Thank you very much for joining us, everyone.
Thank you. Stay creative.
Please stay creative, stay safe, and stay the fuck home. Thank you very much, everyone.
Bye.
It's Friday night.
It's Friday night.
As soon as you're born, make you feel small. Giving you no time instead of it all, till the pain is so big you feel nothing at all. Working class hero is something to be. Working class hero is something to be. You at home, they hit you at school. They hate you if you're clever and they despise a fool. Until you're so fucking crazy you can't follow the rules. Working class hero is something to be. class hero is something to be. When they tortured and scared you for 20 odd years, then they expect you to pick a career. When you can't really function, you're so full of fear. Working class hero is something to be. Working class hero is something to be. Keep you dope with religion, sex and TV. You think you're so clever and classless and free, but you're still fucking peasants as far as I can see. Working class hero is something to be. Working class hero is something to be. Room at the top, they are telling you still. First you must learn how to smile as you kill. To be like the folks on the hill. Working class hero is something to be. Working class hero is something to be. If you want to be a hero, well, just follow me.
Again.